Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another session here at the TV show at ICT Spring. I have three guests. I'm delighted to introduce them all, starting with you. You've just told us about your epic journey, but only from France. I know you've traveled around the world a few times. It's Sean Cleary, Vice Chair, FutureWorld Foundation. We've got Nasir Zubairi, the CEO of the Luxembourg House of Financial Technology, the LHoFT, and Thomas Kallstenius, who is CEO of LIST, the Luxembourg Institute of Science and Technology, who wonderfully have their own position directly behind us here in this studio. Great to have you all as my guests. Sean, a delight to have you in Luxembourg. Is it your first time here in Luxembourg?
No, I was actually here the first time about 10 years ago. And it's a very strange thing to say, but the only person that I saw was the Grand Duke.
Well, that's fantastic. Well, welcome back to meet us mere mortals. I don't think the Grand Duke is here today.
He was utterly charming, as are all Luxembourg were that I've met so far.
That's very nice of you. And we're very international as a crowd as well. Now, I'm not going to waste time reading out your CV, which is immense. It's vast, starting off in the Navy in South Africa, moving to various diplomatic roles, Namibia, etc. Your CV is extraordinary. And now I want to talk about your work with a deep core in risk, conflict and resolution. So from all of the lessons that you've learned and the things that you've observed in your life, can you tell us what some key instruments are that you've deployed when it comes to conflict resolution?
Well, to put it in context, I'm a child of the transition around the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s. When the wall came down in Germany, the Soviet Union exploded, and the world was reconfigured in a whole variety of different ways. That affected conflicts in the Middle East, it affected conflicts in sub-Saharan Africa, it affected conflicts in Central Asia, and it affected conflicts in Latin America. And because I had spent a long time in diplomacy, and because I was from Southern Africa, trying to deal with those particular challenges, getting 63,000 Cubans out of Angola, transitioning Namibia to independence, trying to put Mozambique and Angola on track for a transition to democracy, was a very natural extension of what I'd been doing in any event at that point in time. And then as a consequence of the fact that some of those lessons about which you've asked were relevant in the context of the Middle East in particular, but also Northern Ireland in respect of the Good Friday Agreements, we tried to generalize the insights and then sought to find ways of applying them more generally across those landscapes. But I think there are really two very fundamental lessons that one can learn. The first is that everyone lives within their own narrative. So unless you can provide an alternative narrative, you can never resolve a conflict. It doesn't really matter what conflict one's talking about. Everyone lives within their own narrative. So one of the strategies that I guess you apply quite routinely is to say, where would you like X to be 10 years from now or 15 years from now? That, surprisingly, quite a lot of people can agree on, provided you prompt them towards the sort of things that all of us want in the societies that we enjoy. Then you can work back from that particular point once you've collectively reached agreement on where you'd like it to be 10 or 15 years out. You can then say, well, what do we then need to do now or in 3 years' time or in 6 months' time in order to get to that agreed endpoint? But if you don't start with the agreed endpoint at a remove that doesn't require everyone, when defining that, to think about what they have to do immediately, then you can't get to the second phase of the operation.
So it's about stepping stones towards that mutually agreed and mutually perceived endpoint. I then wanted to place us here today. We're at a tech event. What role has technology, the digital world, we've been talking a lot about the metaverse, got in helping aid this work that you do?
Well, I think it's clear, and certainly Thomas knows a lot more about this than I do, but broadly speaking, the advantages of digitization are fairly self-evident. If you think of it in the context of big data,
and then data mining and data analytics, and then the application of machine learning in its various forms on the data that you have extracted for those particular purposes, it's quite clear that you can gain insights which are not available within the operational heuristics of any individual human being. And that's an extraordinary capacity, and unlocking that capacity and deploying it to advantage is absolutely essential now that we're in a position to be able to do it. There are, of course, challenges associated with that. And again, Thomas certainly will know about the rather remarkable article on stochastic parrots and the experiences that range across the Google landscape from concerns about ethics within the framework of using very large language models for data analytical and application purposes in AI frameworks. And then more recently, the rather extraordinary discussion about sentience within Lambda. So, you know, we haven't solved all of these problems yet. We have an extraordinary resource at our disposal. We need to employ that resource, but we need to employ it with humility and with a certain understanding of the limitations that we experience at present.
Well, Sean, you set up a lovely segue there to turn directly to Thomas to ask you more about everything that he's just mentioned that you know so much about. Digitalization, big data, a cornerstone of the work that is carried on at LHoFT. So when we think about the worldview, and Sean does extraordinary work, like I think you said, putting countries on the track for democracy. I'm not sure I've met anyone else in my life whose one of their roles is to put countries on the road to democracy. How can the digital world help when it comes to looking and analyzing the big data that Sean spoke about?
I mean, so we like to think that we cannot only think about digitalization. We think that the European Commission has always talked about this twin transition towards a more sustainable and digital society. We think there's a third dimension now, and that's also a more resilient society. And a resilient society is a society that can withstand shocks, that can absorb shocks and even improve with the shocks, basically. And what we see now is a lot of shocks to our society. We have COVID, we have floodings in Luxembourg, and we have this very unfortunate war in Ukraine. And actually, one of the deep thinking is that, and I'd like to come back to the thoughts of Nassim Taleb, who coined something called antifragile, is that you can build a system based on artificial intelligence cannot only improve the, let's say, the sustainability and the resilience, but it can also improve it. So we learn from what's going on, and using AI, we can actually become better. And that's the essence of a deep learning system used for our society. And that's where digitalization plays a very instrumental role. If we can do that, we can actually build a system that becomes better with shocks. And that's a tempting idea, no?
It's very nice that you add in this word about resilience and having that mindset to try to make things better. But of course, that raises quite a number of ethical questions within the research and development too.
That's true, but that's also the role of a public research institute to raise these ethical questions. If we don't raise these questions, if we don't discuss them, we can never solve them. So I think they should be raised, and they should be discussed with thought leaders of different disciplinarities. But it's a time to bring them on the table. And I mean, I'm a techno-optimist. I think we can solve it, but we need to address them and spell it out. And that's what we do here.
Nasir, with the Luxembourg House of Financial Technology, FinTech, it has a base in FinTech, financial technology, but you also have a lot of work that you carry out in African countries. Can you tell us about some of that work?
Yes, sure. An aspect of Luxembourg that sometimes gets forgotten is its strength and work in financial inclusion and specifically microfinance. Most people focus very much on the investment fund industry, the insurance industry, private banking. But Luxembourg is also the European Center for Microfinance Funds. And there are a plethora of organizations in Luxembourg that are obviously working to do good, to improve conditions across the world in developing markets. We have, since the very beginning of setting up the LHoFT 5 years ago, run a program which is specifically focused on financial technology companies, most of whom typically are based in African countries, some of them maybe in Europe, targeting Africa, to see what value add we can deliver from the expertise of Luxembourg, from the expertise of our finance sector and the wonderful experts we have in Luxembourg. We bring over usually between 12 to 14 firms for one boot camp a year, all expenses paid, expose them to the expertise we have here, and really try and see how we can look at it as minimizing their risk of failure. So rather than looking at improving their chances of support, because it's failure that kills businesses. It's great ideas just need to be nurtured along their way. So, and that support continues way after the program as well. We have very strong connections to all of the firms that have gone through this program over the past 5 years. Some of them have even chosen to set up particular offices in Luxembourg to be close to the expertise and the people that they've met here. But what we're very proud of is the way that these businesses have, on the whole, gone on to become very strong, very resilient, and really add value in their local ecosystems, be it in Uganda, in Rwanda, in Kenya, in Morocco, in Egypt, and really make a difference to the world of financial inclusion and bringing more people into the world of finance.
And sticking with the world of finance and how easy it is for most people with a mobile app to gain access to, well, it's a form of fintech with our phones. When you look at the African countries, for example, or other countries where poverty might be an issue, do you think there's a democratization that's made available to people with the use of apps, financial apps?
Absolutely. I'm an honorary research fellow at UCL in London, and through that position, I've been able to get access to some PhDs and who helped me play with some of the theories I've had in my career as to how innovation works. And one of these theories I've had is a sort of what I call the normalcy of innovation, and how innovation typically leapfrogs over in different countries. So a mobile is actually a very good example, where in the sort of mid-90s, early noughties, Europe was actually way ahead in terms of mobile phone technology than the US, right? Because the US had a fairly good system at the time. They didn't see the incremental benefit, and so the technology didn't go as fast there. Whereas here in Europe, we took on much more advanced technology, and then the US leapfrogged us again, and it's all sort of tended towards a normal where we're all on the same playing field. In financial services, where you have countries such as Egypt, where 60 million people don't live within 5 kilometers of a bank or an ATM, the mobile de facto becomes the tool of choice. The incremental value, the mobile phone, and the ability to conduct financial transactions, to make payments from that device, adds so much significant value, it's de facto adopted by the masses. Whereas in Europe, what we see is that we're still generally tending to continue using our credit cards, because that is fairly efficient, because we have tap to pay. Mobile adoption of finance, be it that we use apps for banking, we don't typically use apps for payment quite as much as you see in developing markets. So the mobile's added incredible value in developing markets.
Sean, I want to turn back to you. You are vice president of this global world think tank. When it comes to global issues, what do you see as the things that businesses, individuals, entrepreneurs should be thinking about to try to solve?
Well, I think, you know, you've got to go back to basics in respect of all of this. And if I can just piggyback on something that Nasir has said here, I think one of the things that happens in innovative spaces is that when there are fundamental obstacles to achieving a standard that has become accepted as appropriate, people find solutions. One of the reasons why mobile telephony spread so fast in sub-Saharan Africa and in India, for example, was because there was no fixed line telephony of any scale outside of limited urban centers. So therefore, it was a market dying for a solution to happen, and it expanded extraordinarily fast in those markets. The first payment options, as Nasir knows very well, were in fact around something in East Africa called M-Pesa, for the simple reason that there were a tremendous number of people paying remittances back to home countries who didn't have any means of doing that because they weren't banked and they weren't bankable. So as a consequence of that, there was a payment app developed utilizing mobile technology, which for a considerable period of time was in fact state of the art in the world at large. And that, I think, is how innovation happens. Now, if you take that and apply it to your question, the only justification for the existence of a government is to enable the well-being of its citizens and those within its borders. Otherwise, we don't need governments.
But that isn't always the case.
Of course not. Of course not. But it is precisely how we should be thinking about this issue. So governments only serve a purpose if they enable well-being. What does that mean in practice? Well, it means that they have to create an equitable environment, not equality. No one is actually equal to anyone else. But the environment has to be fair. It has to be just. It has to be equitable in that sense. The second thing is that individuals must have an appropriate level of human security. It's not really a question of global security or regional security or national security that drives the concerns of most people on the planet. It's their personal circumstances. It's whether they can buy something without it being stolen or cross a street without being killed. So human security is the second driver of well-being for the vast majority of humanity. And some part of that is economic. Some part of that is community support. Some part of that is political freedom. But it's a combination of things that governments need to engender in those environments. And then the third is what we can generalize as sustainability. And sustainability is actually just intergenerational equity. There's that wonderful phrase, which is that we don't leave the future to our children, we borrow it from them, right? And if you use up more of the resources in your generation than others will be able to enjoy in theirs, you have behaved in an utterly inequitable manner, and that's a fairly nasty thing to do to your children and grandchildren. So governments need to get their minds around those issues, and the sort of digital instruments and other related technological capabilities that we are now unlocking at scale are terribly important ways of developing new insights into how we can achieve those objectives in a coherent way.
Well, what an eloquent way of talking about sustainability, a phrase I haven't heard precisely in that manner before. Turning to you, Thomas, it's another pillar of the work that you do at LHoFT, sustainability and how you think about that. So given everything Sean said, please pick up on how you work with sustainability at LHoFT.
Oh, I mean, 100% subscribe to what you say. It's also very much in line with the Brundtland definition's way of defining sustainability as the right for also for future generations to live their dreams and hopes while still creating a sustainable society here and now. And this is why we also as technologists, we try to create this, let's say, framework where we can understand the impact of certain decisions here today, but also into the future, because we need to simulate and understand what the impact is of certain actions here today, but also into the future, in order to give the right to our children to also live their dreams as they deserve to do. And, you know, coming back to, we borrow it from them. So one of our leading values is what we call sustainability by design. And it's technically comes from something called security by design, where we changed very much the security industry, you know, 10 years ago, where we started to design solutions with security by design. So they're always designed with security in mind. And we believe that we should pull off the same trick for sustainability. We should develop technologies and solutions which are already taking sustainability into account in the design phase. And this becomes very concrete because companies usually have a development cycle with a stage gate. And if you think about sustainability already in the design phase, the rest will follow through. And this is why sustainability by design is for us a leading terminology, but we also try to apply it to LHoFT, but also spread a bit the methodology around us. And hopefully that will help a bit, at least our partners, to become more sustainable and their solutions as well. So.
And when it comes to finance and sustainability, the world of finance is changing rapidly right now. You've spoken about some ways in which it's changing. We're moving towards a cashless society in so many ways. What is your view of sustainability and finance and how that can work together?
There is a huge focus in Luxembourg, particularly as considered one of the core strategic pillars of the finance sector, to develop the sustainable finance area. And Luxembourg already has a huge lead over any other country in the world in terms of assets under management in sustainable funds. However, there are a lot of problems in that area. And to summarize it all, it again comes back to what we spoke about at the beginning, which is data, right? Finding the right data, compiling that data, putting it together in a way that makes sense to be able to control and properly design these sustainable finance products is at this moment very, very difficult. And I know Thomas's teams are working on some of these potential solutions around this. The other aspect, I think, of sustainable finance is what worries me a little bit is that when you consider that finance is there to finance the real economy, it does worry me somewhat that finance is trying to impose a set of criteria and rules on that real economy when the real economy isn't quite ready to be sustainable, particularly when we're talking about SMEs where they're cash management and profitability is always relatively thin. And then imposing restrictions on access to capital to these businesses on the basis of them fulfilling sustainable criteria of their business, it could potentially cut off access to that capital because they simply can't do it in any near-term timeframe. I think we need to be quite balanced about how we look at the controls in financial services, make sure that we work hard in terms of building the right data solutions so we can monitor and assess the impacts and make good decisions. But we also, you can't look at it just in its own silo. It has to work hand in hand in a very complex network around the world with technologies and developments that allow for sustainability in the real economy, the what governments are imposing in terms of strategies around CO2 emissions and other elements around the general stock of a country. It's a very complex situation, but ultimately it's something we have to tackle, but it has to be tackled holistically, not in silos.
Picking up on the word complexity there, I want to turn to you again, Sean, because you have you sit on so many boards on so many continents. The world is complex, but do you see any umbrella themes throughout the world in terms of how things can improve? Because your whole life's work is about improving situations. So when it comes to the complexity of the world, how can you simplify those thoughts and the things that you see on the ground? But you are literally working as a global citizen to try to make things better. So how do you dig into all of those various countries within all of those various continents and try to resolve what you see as complex problems? You have to really actually make them simple.
You know, there's a wonderful expression, and it's been variously attributed to Einstein and Max Planck, and I've no idea who said it because I've never found it in either one of their writings. But the characterization is one should always try to simplify complexity, but not beyond the point at which it becomes reasonable. So one has to understand what we mean when we say that the world is a complex dynamical system. What we mean is that we've engendered a level of connectivity within a system such that there are a huge number of nodes, a tremendous amount of feedback that occurs within the system. We very frequently can't attribute causality in any plausible way. Nothing is monocausal. A never causes B, but A may cause G, F, Q, and A feeding back into C. And as a consequence of all of that, this world is continuously in a process of emergence and occasionally on the verge of chaos. There are multiple metastable states within this system,
and the outcomes are not distributed in terms of a Gaussian curve, but in completely non-Gaussian ways. Now, that's the problem. It's not going to go away. It won't change in your life, never mind in mine. So as a consequence of that, we've now got to try and grapple with it. How do we deal with that? And as all of us know, the truth is we're not mentally equipped to deal with complexity in the way in which I've described it. The way we solve for these problems is through something that we can think of as operational heuristics. I know that we're sitting in a television interview. I've done one or two in my life beforehand. I know broadly what your expectations are. I know what my fellow panelists' expectations are. So I will behave broadly in that fashion. If you throw a curveball out of left field, it'll catch me off balance. But so far, you haven't. That's an operational heuristic. I came into that expecting that things would operate in a particular way. And that's how policy is made in the real world. It's never fit for purpose. It's never good enough. It creates enormous degrees of frustration among all of us, quite often. But we can use some of the new technologies that are emerging in this space to create additional capability and, as Thomas has already said, greatly enhanced resilience in these contexts. So that's broadly what we have to try and grapple with. We have to understand our limitations. We have to understand the scale of the challenge. Anyone who's tried to command their children knows that you can't command humanity. It doesn't make any sense. So the idea that you can issue edicts and then expect that everyone will comply is completely idiotic. And that comes back, in a certain sense, to Nasir's question or observation about how to deal with asset allocation in the overall context of sustainability. Mark Carney had a very clever thought at one stage of the game where he introduced the idea that there were going to be stranded assets in fossil fuel companies, and hence the valuations of those companies didn't justify their allocation of resource within the application of unlocking the value of the assets that they had for 40 years going out. Because if you couldn't dig coal out of the ground, it wasn't worth anything on your balance sheet. That's a relatively easy one in the context of what Nasir was describing. When you get a legal philosophical proposition which says we shouldn't invest in fossil fuel companies, that's a different proposition. That's not premised on an economic consideration. It's premised on a moral social consideration. Probably correct as it happens, but nonetheless, it's a different line of argument. And then you get into the problem that we've now got in Europe as a consequence of Russia's invasion of Ukraine, where there are huge strains in terms of energy security, precisely because what was assumed to be a stable supply of energy has now been interrupted for political reasons. And all of a sudden, people are reverting back to coal. Coal prices have gone through the roof. Oil prices have risen very substantially. Gas prices are going to continue rising for some time. So the principle that we were articulating 12 months ago is being defied in practice by reality having intruded on the situation. And that, I think, illustrates the challenge that Nasir was describing.
I know that Thomas wants to come in on a few things here.
I love this discussion. I'm also a big fan of all your quotes, by the way. So now, I mean, if you look to what we have done with innovation over time, is actually we have started to distribute things, right? We, you know, ages ago, we were all self-confined. We were sitting in the same place, energy was around us. We talked a few meters from each other. And over time, we started to distribute ourselves. We travel more. We distribute information. We have the internet. We distribute energy. We get it from all places. So this distributed world is much more complex, and it's also more sensitive. And that's why the resilience question comes into mind. But I think that sustainability has a price, and it's a cost. And one of the complexities is these externalities, because many of these costs are shared costs. So as technologists, we can develop some technologies to solve this, but we cannot solve this problem with externalities. Here we really need good policies, because I think we need to put a cost on sustainability, and then we should let the market drive it. But that cost should be done in a clever and fair way. And
we need to take the cost of externalities into account. Otherwise, it's not a fair price. I'm not sure if that resonates with someone who is more an economist than me, but that's a bit how I see it. And, but we try to develop the technologies behind it, and that's what we do at least.
I'm also thinking when we're talking about something like fossil fuels and what's happened currently with oil and everything, that we have to deal with borders. And we have to continually deal with continental borders, country borders. You've seen this through your whole life as a diplomat. You've also spent time studying in Iran. I would like to know what your thoughts are on how we deal with borders and crossing borders. And you said before that people care about their local communities, but actually we're here in a digital world, so we're not living locally anymore. But I've asked a few things there, but really it's coming down to the fact that we're not living with borders all the time. We also live globally.
Well, there's three parts to the answer to that question, and I certainly couldn't formulate a comprehensive answer on all levels, but three things strike me. The first goes to the point that Thomas has just made, this concept of a distributed world under present circumstances. What have we done? We've connected the privileged amongst us in the most remarkable number of ways over a period of about 35 years now. From about the middle of the 90s, we started doing this at scale. The Asian financial markets crash was due in part to a flood of money coming back to New York and London and Frankfurt and Paris and Zurich at speed, digitally empowered, at a point at which people became nervous about the risk of assets crashing in Southeast Asia at that point in time. So from then onwards, we have progressively integrated financial systems, supply chains, a variety of manufacturing capabilities. Think of Airbus as a perfect example in terms of the number of places from which elements are sourced. Think of an iPad or any other Apple product, the great majority of which is actually manufactured in China. All of those elements we have engendered, and that's before you get into the internet per se and social media as an additional layer in terms of all of that. This has done something very dangerous, actually. It's disempowered national governments. National governments today do not have the same ability through the application of policy to either advance the well-being of their citizens or to provide protection to them in certain circumstances because of the interconnectedness of the global economy and particularly financial flows. Now, all of that is producing a significant degree of tension even within countries, never mind across borders. There are things that cause tensions across borders, but there are things that are causing tensions within countries as a consequence of this. And we have to find new ways of being able to square all of these circles. We have to be able to continue extracting the benefits that are associated with levels of high connectivity, the scale of the financial economy relative to the real economy increased between 2000 and 2008, when the financial crisis struck, up to 21 times. The financial economy was about 21 times the aggregate size of the real economy of the world at that point in time. And that's one of the reasons why we got the scale of the crash that we got. And it's one of the reasons why COVID engendered the scale of the financial recession that we experience as a result of that. So connectivity, just like sustainability, has its costs. And what we have to find ways of doing is to rebalance between our collective identity as humans on a planet, privileged beings who are in many countries in the course of any 12-month period under ordinary circumstances, who exchange thoughts and ideas and insights and perspectives with an enormous number of people, some of whom we've never met and some of whom we only meet very occasionally. That's quite different to the way that anyone has lived on this planet in previous centuries. And we haven't got instruments of governance that can advance the well-being of citizens and those within the borders that actually grapple with these particular challenges in a meaningful way.
Sean, Nasir, Thomas, this is such a wide-ranging conversation, and I know with all of your experiences and expertise, we could talk for the entire afternoon, but I have to move on to our next guest. But hopefully you can continue this conversation amongst yourselves, and thank you for all of the wonderful work that you do here in Luxembourg and all around the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.